Hi, you are in the ladies' room with Dr. Donica, the only public ladies' room you can enter anytime without ever waiting online. I'm your host, Dr. Donica Moore. We'll be having real conversations with real women about really intimate issues. They may be embarrassing, sad, or funny, but they will always be interesting and informative. You know, like the best conversations you've had in ladies' rooms with your best friends, or total strangers and a physician. Please join us.
Hello, and welcome to the Ladies' Room. Our guest today is Susan Spencer, the editor-in-chief of Women's Day, which, as most of you know, is the top-selling monthly magazine in American newsstands. It has a readership of 22 million women, and I hope you're all listening. But in all seriousness, chances are, if you are a woman who's listening, you know that Women's Day is an inspirational source of information for American women. You know its content speaks to readers' values, our everyday needs, and empowers women to enrich their lives with joy, purpose, and positivity. Now, one of my favorite things about Women's Day is that it has been a dominant force in the fight against heart disease for nearly two decades, and was one of the first major voices to kind of raise the alarm about the fact that heart disease is the number one killer of women as well as men. In 2013, under Susan's leadership, the brand created a heart health focused editorial franchise, which I love, called Live Longer and Stronger, which helps five women each year navigate their way towards lowering their heart disease risk factors and lose weight. Of course, the group reveals their success stories and their collective 200 plus pound weight loss in the March issue of Women's Day every year, as well as live on the Today Show. They're also celebrated at the Women's Day Red Dress Awards, which is Women's Day's signature annual event, which just celebrated its 15th anniversary.
Yay!
Yay! And I was there, not in the front row, in the second row. And I have to say, I was one of the people there who got to raise my hand when Susan said, who was here for the first Women's Day Red Dress Awards? So it was really one of those you've come a long way, baby, kind of moments.
And I had no idea you were the first one. That's fantastic.
I was with Daryl Hannah. And of course, you know, at this one, I was sitting right behind Star Jones, who I had worked with on The View in the past, and Tamron Hall, who I had worked with on NBC and the Today Show. So it was really also kind of like old home week. And of course, it was wonderful to celebrate Dr. Jennifer Ashton getting her award from your organization, as you know, doing so much not only as a physician, but also as the chief medical correspondent for ABC. And Jen is going to also be one of our guests, and I will just tease her topic because I love her topic, and it's based on a panel I think that you did together, which is called the Heart is a Lady Part.
Yes.
I love that. Because usually when we talk about the lady parts, we talk about our quote-unquote private parts.
Right, exactly.
And not our necessarily most important parts, which in my personal opinion are the heart and the brain.
Yes.
So,
right.
And of course, as I always say on this show, the brain is the largest sex organ, but that's for another time. Anyway, I just have to finish telling everybody all of your, well, I can't get into all of your accomplishments, but just that the headlines, I'll be the headline writer here. Prior to joining Hearst, Susan served in senior editorial positions at All You Magazine, Child, and Diversion Magazines. She currently serves on the boards of Safe Horizon, which is the nation's largest nonprofit victim services organization. And that's a topic we've covered quite a bit on this show. We've talked about domestic violence. We've talked about everything, Me Too. We've talked about rape, sexual assault. I think we'll probably be talking about it more. And Susan is also on the board of the Women's Leadership Council of Women Against Alzheimer's, which we also talk a lot about. I think that's my number one most feared disease. But I want to give everybody the breaking news on this podcast that here it is, that tomorrow your new book is coming out. Yeah. And I love the title, and it's so appropriate for what we're going to talk about today, When Action Follows Heart, 365 Ways to Share Kindness Every Day of the Year. So what a great way to combine talking about heart disease and talking about your new book, which I know you want to talk about. And in preparation for this, do you have any idea? I meant to look this up and I didn't have time. But historically, how did the heart become known as the seat of emotion? You know, how is that linked between heart and love and kindness and goodness?
Well, I think that's a really good question. I don't know the actual historic answer to it, but I think that, I mean, the heart is really the engine that drives everything. I mean, you know, you mentioned the brain connection. It fuels our bodies. It fuels the way we move. But I think it also, the heart really houses our capacity to love. Mm-hmm. I wish I knew the origin of it. I don't.
I'm going to say Aristotle. If I was on a game show, I would, if Meredith Vieira was asking me, you know, if I want to phone a friend or whatever, I would say probably Aristotle, because he was very into the four humors.
Yes.
And the life source. And blood.
Yeah.
Blood was always considered, you know, a life-fulfilling, mm-hmm. life-affirming kind of organ. But if any historians are listening, you know, please
tell me.
Me know.
I'd love to know.
And the first historian that gets back to me gets to be a guest on the podcast and tells all about it.
Yeah, but I think that it really is, when we think about sort of women's health in general, I think the heart is really at the heart of the matter, right? I mean, it's right there. And it really is, I think that sometimes women don't think about how central it is mm-hmm. to their well-being. Mm-hmm. And that's part of the reason why I think heart health and heart disease are often overlooked a little bit by women. I mean, we think very hard and we get very scared about things like breast cancer, mm-hmm. but in fact, you're more likely to have a heart attack than to get breast cancer. So,
well, you're actually 10 times more likely to die of heart disease than you are of breast cancer. But of course, fear is a very motivating factor. I was very proud of the writers at Grey's Anatomy. They just mm-hmm. did an episode recently where Bailey, their chief surgeon, who's 50-something, actually, I think she's in her late 40s, actually has a heart attack.
Yeah.
And she is not taken seriously, even though she is a surgeon, and she goes in saying, I'm having a heart attack, because symptoms in women present very differently than what I call the Hollywood heart attack.
Right, exactly.
Which is like, clutching pain.
Right. I mean, and that doesn't happen. It can manifest in many, many, many different ways, from nausea to numbness. And I think that it's also, we've seen, and we've done some work on this at Women's Day, we've reported on this, that even women who go to emergency rooms and they say, I'm having a heart attack, they're often not taken seriously.
Well, that was how they did it in Grey's Anatomy.
Right, exactly.
Which is exactly how they did it.
Is that, you know, people are, you know, CPR is something that can save a life, but people are hesitant to do CPR on women, and women are hesitant to do CPR. And there's easy ways to do CPR that don't involve, you know, mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. But it's interesting how, you know, we seem to have kind of, you know, we seem to understand cancer in a way, but heart disease feels, and maybe it goes back to what you were saying about it being one of the four humors, it just feels so personal, right? It's very personal.
Well, I think also people are very confused about the difference between heart disease and heart attack.
Mm-hmm.
So I think people pretty much understand what a heart attack is. But for most people, a heart attack is a manifestation of having mm-hmm. already had heart disease for many years.
Right.
There is a type of heart attack that you can have. And the theory is many women may have this second type of heart attack more frequently, which is as a result of vasospasm. So mm-hmm. one of the major coronary vessels would just be constricted so much that it would be coming and cutting off blood supply to the heart.
Yeah, right.
That's all a heart attack is blood supply to the heart being cut off. Very similar to a stroke, which is the blood supply to the brain being mm-hmm. cut off. So actually people, you know, brain researchers are very offended that heart disease gets so much more attention than stroke. So they started actually calling stroke a brain attack.
Yeah, that's actually
much more dramatic.
Yeah, that's very, very true. Yeah.
So tell us all the ways that Women's Day has really focused on heart disease and made heart disease in women a huge priority.
Well, I think that we've, you know, you mentioned the Red Dress Awards, which you attended 15 years ago with Daryl Hannah. I still can't believe that you were there and she was the host. So
fun fact. She was not wearing a red dress.
Well, that's
and I was like, seriously? Red Dress Awards.
Right. Well, it was the first one. We have, you know, you have to get people sort of used to this idea. So when I started at Women's Day and saw that we had this incredible history that my predecessors had built about work and advocacy and information around heart health, I decided to kind of build on it. And my funny story about Red Dress Awards is I started my job on February 1st. The Red Dress Awards were on February 9th.
Wow.
A couple of days before they actually told me that I was going to have to make a speech in front of 500 people. Mm-hmm. So, but I managed to get through that incredibly traumatic first time, and it's gotten easier since. But I think it really was at that first event where I really just saw the passion that people had for this. And of course, it was a room that had a lot of cardiologists in it. So obviously, there's a lot of passion for the
heart.
And
the president of the American Heart Association there, and many nurses who are cardiac care nurses. In fact, one of your honorees was a nurse from Nashville.
Yeah, exactly. So it was really at that first one where I sort of thought, this is something where Women's Day really has a lot of skin in the game on this topic. So how can we build this? So what we did, not that first year, but the year after, we started something that you alluded to before called the Live Longer and Stronger Challenge.
I love that. I want to know how I could be a patient in that.
Well, you can enter. It's we have right now, we're about to pick our sixth class, and I think we have well over 1,000 entered. So we go through a long process, and we winnow it down. We finally pick five women. And we do all this in conjunction with Joy Bauer, who is, of course, the Today Show's nutritionist, but she's also a Women's Day columnist and writes a monthly column for us. So what we do is we sort of sick Joy on these five women. We put them in this program that involves not just sort of eating plans and diet plans, but she gives them exercise tips. They have a Facebook group that they interact on. They get weekly advice from cardiologists. We've worked with Mayo Clinic in the past. So we really kind of give them this pathway towards health. And as you mentioned before, they're all women who have or are at risk of heart disease. So there are women in there who have had very serious heart attacks and who are really in recovery. And then there's women who have an incredible family history. I think there was one woman this year whose father had 7 heart attacks.
Oh my gosh.
And then women who have had parents who died at the age that they are now. Mm-hmm. So that's a huge wake-up call for them. So whatever their motivation, they kind of come into this very, very, and want to be very involved in this and very serious about it. And what we've seen over the course of this, and it's usually about 8 months, are these really kind of intrinsic lifestyle changes that really take root with these women. It's not just sort of like, oh, I'm on a diet and I'm going to do this so I get to, be on the Today Show. It's more like they are really, really changing their lives.
And that, of course, is the punchline, right? The punchline is that even though heart disease is this horrible, long-term, terrible disease with often terrible, not only morbidity, but also mortality, we know that with lifestyle and behavioral changes, you can reduce your risk for heart disease by 80%.
Exactly.
I don't think there's any other thing in medicine where you could reduce your risk by 80%, perhaps in terms of lung cancer and not smoking.
Right.
But of course, not smoking also reduces your risk of heart disease, which is one of the behaviors, but many behaviors increase your risk. I just want to throw in, what are the things you can't change? The risk factors for heart disease that are not changeable. Mm-hmm. As hard as I've tried, you cannot change your parents.
So no, that's true.
You cannot change your genetic.
Your family health history.
You're stuck with that. You can't change your sex that you were born. Mm-hmm. Not transgender issues notwithstanding, men are still at greater risk if they, people who have an XY chromosome are at greater risk for heart disease. Certainly, you can't change your race. So African Americans are at much greater risk for heart disease than other races, but Native American Indians are at the next greatest risk than Hispanic and then whites, and Asians are at the lowest risk.
Right.
In part, possibly because of lifestyle and behavior, but also in part because of genetics. Mm-hmm. So those are the things you can't change, but everything else is negotiable now.
Right. And it's completely negotiable, and it's reversible. That's what's so amazing about it. And I think that women sometimes feel overwhelmed when they get a diagnosis of high blood pressure or high cholesterol, and a doctor says to them, oh, you need to lose weight. And that, talk to any woman about their weight, and it's really personal, right? It's like, you don't want somebody to say that to you, but you kind of know you have to. And I think that it can lead to a little bit of paralysis. Mm-hmm. And I think one thing that we've tried to do through the Live Longer and Stronger program and having these women kind of go out and talk about what they're doing and showing them on the Today Show and showing them in the magazine is sort of saying to women, this doesn't have to be hard. Mm-hmm. That you don't have to change everything. You know, you don't have to wake up one morning and say, okay, I'm having kale for breakfast, then I'm going for a 5-mile run, and then I'm going to, then I'm going to have a spinach salad for lunch, and then I'm going to eat nothing for the rest of the day, and then I'm going to go to bed and get 8 hours of sleep. Because, you know, who's going to do that, right? I mean, I don't do that. I'm pretty healthy. I'm sure you don't do that either.
No, I don't. And I'm somebody who definitely could improve my health habits. Actually, we did a podcast interview a couple of weeks ago with Dr. Octavia Kennan, who is the president-elect of the American College of Osteopathic Obstetricians and Gynecologists. And we talked about taboo topics in OBGYN. Yeah. And believe it or not, weight management and talking about your weight with your gynecologist is a big taboo topic.
Yeah.
The fact is, almost every single woman who needs to lose weight not only knows that she does need to lose weight, but she knows how much.
Right.
The patients we really have to worry about are the patients who don't have to lose weight, who have body dysmorphia. That's a whole nother topic.
Right.
But talking about it is painful for people.
It is.
Admitting it. The great thing that Joy brings to this program, and I think it's fabulous that her name is Joy, because she is just full of joy and happiness. And in her speech, she talked about at the Red Dress Awards, talking about the program, she talked about making it fun. And how that really brings such an important element to the program. And then the women talked about, I had the pleasure of talking to several of them at the reception afterwards, and they talked about this bond that they formed on the Facebook group and how they get together and how they call each other when it has nothing to do with this program, but because they need support. But I want to switch gears a little bit, speaking about Joy's speech at the Red Dress Awards. Your speech was terrific. And I said that behind your back also, not just, but there was a moment in your speech when you had, what were there, 500 people there?
Yeah.
You had everybody on the edge of their seats, not breathing, when you started telling a story, a personal story about your own daughter. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to take the punchline. I want you to tell the story, and I want you to do it just like you did it.
I'll do my best.
And leave us breathless and hanging, and then save us from that.
Yeah. Well, so in my speech, I talked about, I've been editing stories about women's hearts. I've been writing about women's hearts. I've been giving speeches about women's hearts, for basically the last 6 years, but I've never actually seen a human heart. And I just literally a few months ago had that opportunity, because I had to take my daughter, my 14-year-old daughter, to a pediatric cardiologist because she had a heart murmur. Mm-hmm. And so he did an ultrasound. So I was, she was lying there, and she was scared. You know, it was scary, although the cardiologist was excellent and very much put her at ease. But he was doing an ultrasound. So I was watching on the screen, watching her heartbeat. And, as a mother, it just floored me, because to see your child's heart is just, there's something kind of symbolic about that. But then I started peppering him with questions and then he wanted to know why I was asking so many questions. Anyway, the upshot of it was that my daughter's completely fine. She's, has absolutely no problems. It's a completely, benign, I think they call it a benign murmur. I can't
benign,
remember.
Yeah, benign murmur. Incidental.
And she'll just, every once in a while she'll be monitored for it. It was not that big a deal. But it really hit me. It hit me as a mother, because not just because I was worried about her health, but to see this kind of instrument on screen just sort of doing what it does, just that rhythmic beating, and just watching the different, it looked a little bit like a whale, I have to say. but just watching it do its business, it was just really I sort of thought to myself, this is kind of what it's all about. This is what we are, why we are here tonight at this award ceremony, why we honor people who are working so hard in this field to do research, to bring more women into research, which is so critical. And it's sort of, I guess it kind of crystallized why so many people are passionate about this, and why I'm passionate about it as well.
Yeah, what you did to us though that night, mm-hmm. is you said, I've never seen a heart before until the night I saw my daughter's heart. That's what you did to us there. And that's when everybody just went silent, because we were like, oh my God, how did she see her daughter's heart. And by the way, that reminds me of my favorite quote of all time. I know you have two children. I also have two children. When I was pregnant with the second child, I was just overwhelmed by this feeling that I didn't know how I could possibly love another human as much as my first child. And that was very stressful for me until I saw two quotes. The first was, making the decision to become a mother is like making the decision to forever watch your heart walking around outside your body. And what I was thinking when you're talking about your daughter's heart exam, which is called an echocardiogram, ultrasound of the heart, I was thinking, did you have an ultrasound when you were pregnant? And did you see her heart when you were pregnant?
Well, I did with my older daughter. My younger daughter is actually adopted. So I did not see it.
You did not see it. So this was the first time seeing
her. This was the first time I'd seen the inside of her body. So that's actually a good point. I hadn't thought about that. And I did tell her when we were doing this procedure, I did tell her that the last time I had seen something like this was with her sister, and she was interested by that. So that kind of put her at ease a little bit.
That's
more.
Great. And you should probably get her a book.
Yeah.
DK makes these wonderful books for teens that are highly illustrated. And there's even like pop-up books that you could get that show the inside of your heart. And this could be a wonderful teaching experience and motivating experience for everybody else who's listening. What a heart murmur is, it just refers to a sound that the doctor can hear when we use our stethoscopes and listen to the heart. And the sound is very much like, it's not a clean cut. And what it sometimes indicates is that the valves are not closing properly.
Right,
and it depends on where the sound is, what kind of sound it is. And now, you know, in the old days, we just had to kind of guess and listen. You know, now we can look and we can actually see how the valves are closed, if they're closing just almost all the way, not so much, totally imperfectly, or insufficiently. And that's how we would grade them. There's four different valves, of course. Many people have benign murmurs that mean nothing. Also, in the old days, mitral valve prolapse, where the mitral valve is not closing properly and can make a murmur, very common in women. And we used to say that all women or all people with a mitral valve prolapse needed to be on antibiotics.
I know that was me.
They had, all right. But now that's not true.
Yeah, so I know. I used to take my pills before I went to the dentist.
For dental cleanings or any kind of procedures.
Yeah.
So now I want anybody who still thinks that to have a conversation with their doctor, because we now know that not only do you not need the antibiotics, but that's a factor that's contributing to antibiotic resistance, which is a huge, huge problem that we have. But the other quote that I wanted to share with you that got me through my second pregnancy and that just moved me, and this is going to segue us into your book, is our first child teaches us about the depth of love. Our second child teaches us about the breadth of love.
Yes.
And I just thought that was so, so profound. So, and that kind of gets us back to this whole concept of the heart and love, as well as the heart and health. So tell us, what is the Kindness Project and how did that influence your putting together this book?
So the Kindness Project is a column in Women's Day that we started a few years ago, and the idea was pretty simple. We were getting a lot of reader mail from people who had sort of were talking to us about the wonderful things that they do for each other. And we decided to kind of make a once in a while column out of it. And we got so many submissions. we were sort of like, oh, this isn't, you know, an easy page to put together. And it sort of fits in the ethos of the magazine. I mean, the magazine is very much about joy and family and community. And you know, we sort of want to be positive. We want to be uplifting. And these stories are just, they're lovely. And some of them are just, you know, little things that people do for each other, and others are sort of on a bigger scale in a community. But whatever it is, it sort of showed us the popularity of the column, which eventually became one of the most popular columns in the magazine. It showed us that people have a capacity for kindness and for generosity that I think sometimes we overlook or we forget about. So the idea of the book kind of sprang out of that. And then I thought it would be fun to do sort of a kind of almost like a calendar. So to think about doing one kind act a day, or you could pick up the book and turn to the day it is and say, you know, today is such and such day. We're going to try this idea. or just to randomly kind of be inspired by the ideas. And we also have stories from readers in the books, and we have some inspirational quotes as well. So it all adds up to basically an act of kindness every day for a year.
Actually, what would be fun as a spinoff, and I'll give you this idea for free, I won't even become your agent, would be a journal spinoff. Mm-hmm. Where people could, you know, a lot of people do gratitude journals, which are wonderful. I've never actually written them down, but when I have trouble sleeping, I just go through every single thing that happened in the day in my mind that I'm mm-hmm. grateful for. And on some days, I have to start with, I'm grateful that I'm still breathing. Yeah, some days I really have to try harder than other days, but yeah. I'm grateful for. But a kindness journal, which would be,
I love that idea. To
write down each day at least one thing they did for other people or for someone else. And it doesn't have to be just one thing.
Yeah.
You know, it could be a whole list.
Yeah.
But it could be also just one thing. Right. And I think what's so moving about these random acts of kindness is that when you do one of them, or when you do one of them, you realize how little effort it took on your part and how easy it was to do something kind for somebody else. Yes. But when you receive one of these random acts of kindness, you realize how the simplest little thing can just change your whole day.
Right, right. Well, I think that when you perform acts of kindness, when you give, that when you get, you're more receptive in a way, you're almost more appreciative to it. And I think the other thing that happened while I was researching the book, I found that I was just much more attuned to it. Mm-hmm. You know, it became like this wonderful exercise in sort of just being aware of the world around me and how I moved through it personally, but also just watching other people and what they did. And there's a lot of anecdotes in the book that really kind of come out of not just, you know, people coming and running into me and saying, oh, this happened to me, but me sort of observing people doing things. And that, that I think, that to me, just personally, just aside from putting the book together, was really meaningful. And it just gives you a different view of the world, you know, when you realize that there's kindness out there.
Well, and I think also kindness, we think of kindness and acts of kindness as very altruistic, you know, as mm-hmm. things we're doing to benefit others. The punchline, of course, is that we often benefit even more than the person who's the recipient.
Because
there's something about human behavior, especially when we're in difficult times ourselves. You know, mm-hmm. if something terrible is happening in our lives, the best way to get out of your own head mm-hmm. is to help somebody else who's in a much more difficult situation.
Right.
Than you are.
Exactly.
Or the best way to make yourself feel like you're an expert or that you're a competent person is to be able to use the skills that you have to benefit somebody else. But as a mother, what I find, and this is very moving, my daughter is very, very focused on helping others.
Mm-hmm.
It just gives me so much pleasure mm-hmm. to watch either of my kids doing something that is just kind.
Right.
And I think there is nothing that makes me feel more proud mm-hmm. as a mother.
But it also makes you feel successful, right? I mean, you feel like
I did a good job.
Exactly. I mean, I think, you know, empathy, when I see my daughters being empathetic, and I think that of all the things that I've tried to drum into them mm-hmm. over the years is empathy. And empathy in every sense of the word, you know.
Right.
From just being kind to people, but also just being sympathetic to the world around you and understanding that there are people who are far less fortunate. There are people who, you know, are living, you know, with difficulty and to try to make an effort to understand those people and their situation. So it's not just about doing, it's also about sort of empathy is a mindset also.
Yeah. One of the things I've learned from my daughter is she lives in Manhattan and there's lots of homeless people. And she goes out of her way to buy lunch for homeless people.
Mm-hmm.
And my attitude at first was the same thing as every other New Yorker, is there's no way we're going to solve the problem of homelessness. And there's no way we're going to solve the problem of food insecurity. And she's like, yeah, but I just solved it for that person.
For one person,
today.
Right.
Yeah. So one of the things I now do is I keep my glove compartment stocked with protein bars and granola bars. And whenever I see somebody on the street who's begging or homeless, you know, I give them a couple of bars.
Yeah, and that's that idea from the kindness book too.
There we go. And I didn't even read that. You didn't even let me look at that. But the thing I want, unfortunately, when we taped this, you didn't have an advanced copy. So I haven't had the privilege of reading it, but I also don't have the pressure of having faked reading it. So that I appreciate. Do you talk about kindness in terms of just act or also in terms of words? Because this is something we have become exposed to in the past year and a couple of months with our current administration, that people have gotten very mean to each other, either in our media, but certainly on Twitter. You know, the things I see adults saying or writing about these wonderful, incredibly motivated students who are championing gun reform. I think these kids are incredible. And not just the Parkland kids who started it, but the kids all over the country. I have never been so inspired by the next generation as much as I have been in the past couple of months. I'm getting goosebumps just talking about it and thinking about what they're doing. But the flip side of that is very ugly, where adults who should know better are saying really awful, personally insulting, mean-spirited things that nobody should say to anybody ever, let alone an adult to a child. If you disagree with their politics, you can say very nicely, "I disagree with your politics."
Right.
You can also say, "But I admire your conviction." Or I admire your efforts. I even heard a story about a recent congressional election where a boy rode through a snowstorm for 2 miles each way on his bicycle in order to vote in his first ever election. He was 18 years old. His parents wouldn't drive him because he was going to vote a different way than they did. And I just thought that was just horrible. Yeah, you know, really horrible. The first time my kids went to vote, I'm taking pictures. And I was almost embarrassed asking how they, you know, how they voted. And at first I even debated, like, is that even appropriate? One child I had to ask, the other child offered. And the child I had to ask was offended that I had to ask. He was like, "Mom, seriously? You had to ask?" So we talk about words.
We definitely talk about words. And we talk about, you know, sort of even something as simple as when you're talking to somebody, be present and look them in the eye. Don't look at your phone. I mean, it's also, there's also a few ideas in there that really are sort of about almost self-regulation in a way, sort of just, you know, and also self-preservation, you know, there's one tip that says, if you've got somebody in your life who just isn't, you know, isn't being kind to you, then give yourself permission, be kind to yourself to cut that person out of your life. So yes, I mean, we sort of talk a little bit about sort of relationships and things like that. But just to go back to what you were saying about kind of the, you know, how, that word, you know, words matter, and they really do. But what worries me about this generation of kids and what they're doing, and I do think there's a lot of resilience there. You know, I do think that they hear some of this stuff from grownups, and, you know, I think most teenagers kind of try to tune that out anyway.
Well, they're good at tuning their parents out, but I don't know how good they are at tuning out other grownups.
Right. Well, that's what I worry about, is that, you know, if we as adults are setting the example that, you know, our response to things that we don't like is to use bad language and to use and to be mean to people, then what are these kids learning? You know, what are they picking up from us? And that, to me, feels the most damaging and corrosive than some, you know, idiot sending off a tweet that, you know, is not nice to a child. You know what I mean? I feel like what we're teaching them is almost worse.
We're trying to teach them, you know, we've really focused on anti-bullying campaigns.
And they've all grown up with that.
And they've grown up with that. And they
inculcated with it.
And they know that. And they're good at it.
Then why don't we know it?
But we're not modeling it.
Yeah.
And I think that is, when we're talking about our children or the whole, it takes a village in terms of how we manage other children with whatever our professions are or our spheres of influence, Children learn by watching us.
Yes,
they learn by watching our behavior, and they model
our behavior. Right, and that's what scares me so much, is that these kids are seeing our response to them. Well, I mean, many of us are responding positively, obviously, and there's an enormous, a lot of pride. But, you know, again, those people who are choosing to make this political or choosing to make this not about their you know, what they've sacrificed and what they believe in. It's not good.
Well, and I think it also shows a real lack of compassion.
Mm-hmm.
The good news is that most of us have not been shot at.
Right.
I personally was almost shot once, just as a passerby, and wow. There was a burglary in mm-hmm. a butcher shop, and gun and bullets were coming out of the windows, and you know, I ran, and yeah. You know, but I'm still affected 40 years later.
That's scary.
It's very, very scary. And I think these kids have not only seen that and lived through that, but they've buried 17 of their friends and teachers.
Right.
Which is, I'm also haunted by the first funeral I ever went to. I was 5 years old. Mm-hmm. One of my friends was killed in a car accident because mm-hmm. he ran into the street. Mm-hmm. And my father thought it was a very good teaching moment to make me go to this funeral so I would see what happens if you run across the street. I still don't cross the street without looking, you know, 14 times.
You absorbed that teachable moment then.
I definitely did, but it's also the subject of many of my nightmares and probably some of the neuroses I've passed on to my children. But I think that's how we develop empathy, compassion. One of the quotes I saw that I don't remember the source of this, and I apologize because it was just so profound, is that when you're with other people, watch your words. When you're by yourself, watch your thoughts.
Right.
And I think the best way we can be kind to ourselves is probably with our thoughts as well as our actions.
Right.
So tell me, what was the most unusual act of kindness that you got to write about?
Well, I'll tell you one that actually I drew from my own life. I don't know if it's the most unusual, but it's something that really, really moved me personally. Not just because it was my father who did this, my father had a friend, a young woman who had a teenage son, and this woman was in a wonderful place in her life. She was engaged, she was about to get married, and her son was killed in an accident at school. And it happened right before this woman's marriage, and my father, who had also lost a son, many, many years ago, I think it really kind of hit his heart in a big way. So they decided to go ahead, this woman and her fiance decided to go ahead with the marriage, but they decided not to go on a honeymoon. And I think that there was some economics involved there also. So my father called up a travel agent and basically arranged a honeymoon for this woman and her husband and paid for it.
Oh, wow.
But he did it anonymously. And she didn't know until... She may have suspected, but she didn't know until years later, after his death, in fact, that he had done this for her. And to me, I mean, it was just sort of, it encapsulates, you know, my father as a person and the kind of the generosity and big-heartedness that he had. But I also really liked the fact that he didn't feel like he needed to be acknowledged. He didn't feel like he needed to be thanked. And I think that there's something about, you know, kind acts. You know, sometimes I think people do it and they want the, you know, they want the, hey, I just did something really kind and, you know, give me a big thank you and let's acknowledge it. But it doesn't have to be that way. And I think my father sort of taught me that kindness can be done very quietly under the radar. And it doesn't have to be about the person who's doing it. It can be very much about the person who's receiving it. Mm-hmm. So kindness comes in many, many different forms. That's just one example. We also in the book just talk about, you know, just sort of fun things, you know, like, you know, a couple of weeks ago, I went and bought something in the vending machine and I left a couple quarters in there, you know, for the next person to come along and go, oh, wow, I found 2 quarters. And, you know, just that moment of fun. And we talk about.
Well, and that's,
you know,
a great feeling when you really, really want a chocolate bar and you don't have enough quarters.
And you don't have a quarter. Exactly. And, you know, another one I think is fun that I've done myself is when, you know, it's a friend's birthday and you, you know, you, you sneak up to their front door and you hang some balloons on the doorknob, or you leave a gift and you ring the doorbell, they just run, you know, you just, so, you know, I wanted these 365 ways to be kind to sort of range from those fun, quick little moments to things that are a little bit more profound. And then to things that are, you know, to your point earlier about that, they're really about us and how we approach the world and how we want people to think about us and the words we use, you know, so it really does kind of run the gamut.
So I think the next book then, so we can come full circle and tie in the acts of kindness to our heart health, is maybe the next book is deals with acts of kindness to yourself.
Yourself, exactly.
You know, ways to be kind to yourself, and how many ways, if you think about it, how many ways today were you kind to yourself?
And I think women have a particular problem doing that. And not just in sort of how it manifests in our health, but just, you know, I always say about myself that I'm my own worst critic. And I think most women are like that. You know, we sort of tend to kind of carry the weight of the world on our shoulders and sort of filter everything through, did I do this right? Did I not do this right? And I think that there has to be at some point kind of a reckoning where you say to yourself, I'm not going to do this anymore, right?
Or I'm going to give myself a pass.
Yeah,
on this particular one issue one day, or even back to the weight issue, because that's the thing I beat myself up about all the time. I was talking to Dr. Cannon about this, you know, in terms of the taboo nature of in the doctor-patient relationship, how most doctors don't want to talk about weight just as much as the patients don't want to talk about it, especially doctors who are themselves overweight. And I shared a story about how I went to my gynecologist one day and I just, from my annual appointment, and I just said, I just cannot be weighed today. I just can't handle it. And I was mostly, I was kind of kidding, but it was kind of true. And I was shocked when she said, okay, fine.
Yeah.
I was like, what? Right. It was that easy?
You mean you're not going to force me to do this?
And then we're not going to have the conversation.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and it was really just great. So anyway, just to wrap up, you know, we've talked about just about everything from heart health and being kind, but this is the ladies' room. And so one of the questions I love to ask our guests is, what's the most unique, interesting, or memorable experience you ever had in the ladies' room? Aside from this interview, of course.
Yeah, of course. I was thinking about this today, and I was thinking about how absolutely just disgusting ladies' rooms can be.
I really disgusting wish meaning filthy.
Filthy. I mean, cleanliness-wise, and I'm not a germaphobe by any means, but I do wish that women would clean up after themselves sometimes. But I was remembering a time that my younger daughter, the heart girl, and I were in London a couple of years ago, and it started to pour, and we got absolutely soaked. I mean, soaked to the bone, you know, just like in a way only a London rain. And so we ran into a museum, and they had these bathrooms in the ladies' room. I mean, it was like walking into a spa. I mean, it was individual. Each toilet had like individual sinks, and it wasn't just, you know, the handicapped areas. It was every single stall. So the two of us went in and we kind of ripped our clothes off and we held them up to the dryer, the air dryer, because there was this incredible, you know, high-tech air dryer. And we just stood there and laughed because it was just so funny that we were standing there basically in our skivvies, you know, holding up our shirts to the dryer. And I was thinking to myself, I don't think I would do this in an American bathroom.
Well, you might not have it. Although I have to tell you, years ago when I was in college, the week before freshman orientation, our school would organize an outdoor action kind of trip, which a lot of kids have, but they also had a New York trip. And I wrote to them before being a freshman, and I said, you know, I can't do the outdoor action trip because of a conflict. I would love to do the New York trip, but I'm from New York, so that doesn't make any sense. Could I be a group leader? And they're like, oh, that's a great idea. And so I was a group leader every year. And one of the things I did as part of the New York trip was making an effort to schedule bathroom breaks at all of the really nice bathrooms, you know, usually in hotels.
You have to figure out which where they are.
Yes, and then we would actually talk about, okay, who had the nicest bathroom? And in those days, it was the Plaza Hotel.
Right, of course.
So I have not kept current on what the nicest bathrooms are, but we definitely could do a much better job.
I think we can.
Cleaning up after ourselves, but also as a society, you know, kind of making an effort to keep our public restrooms.
Those cool European fixtures wouldn't be so bad either. I mean, you know.
I would settle for adequate toilet paper.
That would be good too.
Anyway, thank you so, so much for joining us. This has been fabulous. I know people are going to have tons of questions, and I'm going to post all of them on Twitter and Facebook. Right. Where can people find you other than in Women's Day every month?
Well, I am mostly found on Instagram, which is my all-time favorite social media. So I'm at SusanSpencer2828. So please join me, get a glimpse of my large, sprawling, messy life with my daughters as co-stars. And I have so much fun on Instagram. It's great recommending books and sort of getting a little behind the scenes look at what we do at Women's Day. And it's a lot of fun. So
please, that's great. I never thought about asking people what their favorite social media form is. See, I don't love Instagram. My favorite is Twitter.
You like Twitter. Our audience isn't as much on Twitter. So Instagram and my visual side loves it. It's like, it's nice to think about how do I visually, show what I'm doing. And I'm just getting used to Boomerang and having some fun with that. So,
Your picture is going to be on my Instagram at Dr. Jonica Moore. And we will be promoting this on all the social media channels, but thanks again so much.
You're welcome. Thank you so much.
Take care.
So much fun. Bye-bye.
That's all we have time for today. But let's keep the conversation going on Twitter or Facebook at Dr. Dunica. And please join us next week for another episode of In the Ladies Room with Dr. Dunica. Real conversations with real women about really intimate topics.